Because your photo ops now have been moved, and some of you are under 18 and need to be home before dark. I kid you not. You must ask for your money back, okay? You must ask for your money back. Don't just let them keep your money. If you need to be home by a certain time, that's your parents' responsibility. If you're underage, ask for your money back, okay? Their fault. Questions, and I apologize first right away if there's anybody under 18 and I say anything that's offensive, get over it. I'm sorry, I tried my best. It's always an interesting car ride home with parents when they have kids in the car and go, Mommy, Daddy, what did he mean when he said about this? Notice I bleep myself. Just you wait. Questions from the, I go right to questions. Is that all right? Because this is your moment. This is the day. All right, so I have some for you already. Now shut up. No questions about singing. Go ahead.
Thank you, Ms. Merriman. Congratulations on your wedding.
I'm going to embarrass the hell out of myself again. Yes, Scott and I were traveling in the South, and we were, I think it was somewhere in Mississippi, and you know, there's a lot of, I think it was Mississippi, but there's levees and things like that throughout Mississippi and in Louisiana and all that kind of stuff. Woo! You know what a levee is?
Yes.
It's what we call here a dike, but that's something very different over here. They've all had fingers in them, but you know, it's all different.
Woo!
I'm a lesbian.
About lining.
All right. What are you doing? I got my finger in a dike.
A
So, Scott and I were traveling, and I had the night before eaten some, I'm paraphrasing here, eaten some really, really bad food, okay? And I woke up with a very extremely upset stomach. So we're driving in the middle of nowhere, and we're driving along, and I'm like, Scott, I gotta go to the bathroom. Like, right now. He's like, oh my God, what are we gonna do? I said, we're in the middle of nowhere! There's not even a Stuckey's. Stuckey's don't exist anymore. I know, but I have to, myself. Really, find someplace. He's driving, I'm like, no, find someplace. No. So I had to lift myself off of the leather seats. Really, I had no control. I crapped myself in the car. Driving like this, and went, Scott, just find some place. I got a suitcase in the back. I gotta change my pants. So we drive down by this levee dike, and we drive down, and we stop the car, and I get out of the car, and I'm literally walking like this. Oh my God, oh my, like it's gonna matter because I've already shit myself. So I unbutton my pants, I take my pants off, I'm like, what am I gonna do? What if people drive up? Oh my God, I couldn't believe my luck. Couldn't believe it. Finally work my pants off, work my way off my underwear, I hold them there for a second, clean myself up, put the new underwear on, get my other jeans on. I'm not gonna chuck my jeans out, so I put them in the back in a plastic bag. Oh my God. And I'm like, this is Brian Scott. He's like, what? Look, there's a sign here. I'm just gonna hang it up. It says no dumping. Really quickly, but now everyone's gonna want to do it. Just this one guy. There you go. That's a hand I wipe my ass with. Yes.
Okay, so I've heard in some interviews that you used to collect Star Wars toys in the 70s.
Yes.
Okay, so now you have a bust of yourself, a doll of yourself, and multiple Doctor Who and Torchwood action figures.
Yeah.
So my question is, what is it like having an action figure? And second of all, do you go home and play with yourself all the time?
I love the fact that I'm an action figure. I love the fact that I'm an action hero. I have every single one of the dolls that have ever been made of me. I have all the Doctor Who action figures. I have a room in my house in Wales that is literally filled to the brim with collectibles and stuff that I have. I've got the original Jack Harkness squareness gun, the prop that was made for me, plus I have the one that was made as the replica that was later made because the real one disappeared. I walked out like that, I'm like, yeah, I'm hung. I got a squareness gun in my pocket. Yes, I have a 6-inch, I have an 8-inch, and I have a 12-inch, and I have a 12-inch. And I play with it all the time. It's fully posable.
Hello.
Hi, I just want to thank you, first of all, for coming, because this is amazing.
You're welcome. Thank you. I like to be loud. Go ahead.
And I just wanted to ask you, what do you think, I know like, you just, did you have like a ceremony or anything, or is it just intimate little friends? And if you had a color scheme.
You want details?
I do want details. But also, what do you think of white and TARDIS blue for wedding colors?
White and TARDIS blue for the wedding colors. Are you a virgin? Because who's wearing the white? From that grin on your face, I can tell you're not wearing white at all. Up in the morning, those of you who follow me on Twitter or Facebook or any of the other social media sites, we woke up in the morning and it was actually a text from my sister that said, it's passed. And so we turned on the television. It was about 8 o'clock in the morning in California. We turned on the television, watched the news, we both got very emotional, we kissed and we tweeted it and sent it out, right? And we had already talked about this prior to it, that we would do it as soon as it passed, right? Because if they didn't, if they were able to somehow backtrack on it, we wanted to have it done so we could put up the biggest fight you've ever seen in your life, right? So, move on a couple of days, I can't remember how, it was on the 3rd of July, I think it was, or was it the 4th? You know what that said? I don't remember. I am terrible at dates. And I always, Scott will always say, yeah, do you remember this date? I'm like to my assistant, Reese, what date is this? What's this date? I don't remember. Oh my God. Anyway, so we had a fight in the morning. I know. And he woke up, got up, I had the coffee. He gets coffee in bed every morning. I'm a sucker. Right? So I brought him his coffee and he sat up and he went, so when are you going to propose to me? I went, what? What do you mean me propose to you? I did it last time when we were in Cardiff, when we did the civil partnership. No, you didn't. Yes, I did. Well, what's to say you don't get down here and propose to me? Well, I'm not doing it because you want to do it first and you got to propose. So it was that. And then finally went, fine, we're going to get married. We held hands, we went down to the registrar's office. But the thing that struck me the most, that I have, really, really thrilled me, and really touched me also, is the fact that, you know, Scott and I are I'm 46, Scott's 50, and we consider ourselves still to be quite young. And when we got to the registrar's office in Indio, California, there was not a couple that was under 75 years old. Exactly. And we witnessed three of the weddings for three older couples, and I videotaped them and everything for them. And the guy who is 82 years old, who is the same age as my father, my parents have been married for coming up almost for 60 years. This couple had been married together for over 44 years. And he was in tears and he said, I never ever thought in my lifetime I would ever see this day. So for all of these people, these couples who have been basically hiding who they were for all those years and living together in love but not being recognized by the community. I could fight for another 20 years, but for them, this is a huge thing. And it's more about those couples for me than it is about me because I've got a lot more to go. Two guys today put a lawsuit in against the Dover ruling. You must support them. You must go on to help. Because the young people who can change everything. And if you don't agree with it, then piss off. It's the 21st century. Everything's changing.
Story about myself. But for not the same reasons. I'm pregnant.
Oh, you're pregnant? Oh, so you got something pressing on your plan.
Yes.
Just don't have the baby.
So here's my dilemma.
Alright.
My lovely husband, Jack.
Where?
Jeff.
Wait.
Right here.
Hi, Jeff.
Will not help me pick out a name for a boy. Would you help me? He just won't tell me if he likes it or not. He won't say what he likes.
Maybe he's just letting you choose.
No, he's not.
Ah.
No. Every pregnant woman out there has
really,
lists.
You really
names.
Know what you want, don't you?
All her names are Dr. Who.
All her names are Dr. I mean, as much as...
Where's the problem?
I know, but as much as I love Dr. Who and Torchwood and all the characters that I've played, maybe calling your baby after a little bit might be a little, but I think, and it's a girl, Sarah Jane's fabulous.
It's a boy.
It's a boy.
I even recommended Jack.
You gotta call it Jack.
I even recommended Jack.
You're Jack also, so it could be Jack too. Jack 1 and Jack 2. She is so tired of being in here, isn't she? She wants to go home. Anyway, listen, put it online or something and we'll take a vote over it. I'm sure you'll really love that. You'll figure it out.
Thank you.
You're welcome. Yes.
I love musical theater.
Do you?
I do.
Are you sure you're not a gay man?
I'm not sure. I think
you're not sure. There's some lesbians out in the front here who will help you figure it out.
I was
with me outline, yeah.
I was just wondering what your favorite musical is or favorite song.
Well, I never tend to answer questions that are about favorites because once you say what your favorite is, because of today's social media, it's online and it's everywhere. So I never ever say what my favorite things are. I'm quite happy. The musicals that I've done, I'm quite happy to do all, I've done all of them. I love everyone for different reasons. But there's shows that I like. One of my favorites that I'd love to do one day is Mac and Mabel.
Woo!
But I have to rewrite it. Sorry, Jeremy.
Yeah.
Sorry, because the ending's just crap.
Yes.
It's not a good ending.
Thank
it's not a good ending.
Thank
yeah. So I've already talked to some people who know Jerry, but I know Jerry, blah, 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 so we'll sort it out, maybe a few years down the line. Favorite musical song? Gosh, there's so many out there. I mean, the one thing I loved doing most recently was working with Stephen Schwartz and rewriting just little bits of The Wizard and I to The Doctor and I. And if you haven't heard it, it's on, I think it's on iTunes. You can get it. I recorded it. It's one of my albums. I did it as a tribute to Doctor Who. And it's for me what Captain Jack feels like in being with the Doctor and his relationship with the Doctor. And it's actually really quite a fun song. And I sing the shit out of it.
You sing the shit out of everything.
Thank you very much. I can also hang my shit on signs. Yes. Hi.
I'm a really big fan of your role, Captain Jack, on Doctor Who.
Yes.
And I was just wondering if you knew if you would be playing him anytime soon?
Have no idea.
Aww.
Seriously, that's the only answer I can give you. I have no idea. They have to ask, and I've always said that if they ask at the drop of a hat, I will do it because I absolutely adore Jack. I love the character. I love playing him, and also the fact that Arrow, which I'm on at the moment. I've so just let the cat out of the bag. I'm supposed to be dead. They wanted me back while I'm filming that. They would let me go to do it, but they haven't asked.
Oh.
Ask them. bbc.co.uk. Anyway, yes.
Okay, you said no questions on singing.
Uh-huh.
I'm asking anyway.
like one of those internet things that just happened. I'm the only one on the train. That was all it was. I was the only person on this train going to Essex in the UK. And I recorded that and put it online. Now everybody, like, they put things on going, I'm the only one on the bus. I'm like, it's my song. I'm not the only one on the plane. I'm not the only one on the plane. No, you're not, because it's full! Is that good enough? Thank you. Gentlemen in the green.
Hello, this is more about craft.
I thought we were going to say about crack. I was like...
No, not crack. There is the episode where Captain Jack's grandchild dies. How did you come
Say
to
again?
That? There's an episode on Torchwood where...
Put the mic up to your mouth closer to me.
Sorry.
He's not disagreeing.
There is an episode on Torchwood where Captain Jack's grandchild dies.
Yes.
How did you come to that scene? How did you prepare for it?
I have to be totally honest with you. I am not one of those actors who delves into the depths of their doldrums to find the motivation and the sequence of events that are prior to the moment. I just get up and do it. But I think a lot of other actors are that way also, and I have nothing against the actors who have that progression, except that just hurry up and get to that moment because I really want to go home and eat dinner, right? So we did, on Torchwood, we wouldn't get into those heavy, but I think sometimes when you play the truth of the moment as you're doing it, that is the best way to get the intensity and the truth across. It was a hard scene to do because the young boy, Bear is his name, and he was, not any of the ones that you were. His name was Bear, he's a cute kid, and he said to me, before he said, John, what can I do to make more impact with the scene? I'm like, well, Bear, let me give you some tips. When I turn the machine on and you start, like, you all know what happens, don't you? Yeah, when it goes and it happens, if you want to make it look like it's going to be, you know, terrible, I want you, because he was doing it in a couple of takes, it was just plain and then he would fall and da-da-da. I said, Bear, start shaking a little bit and then start violently shaking. Tell wardrobe or makeup to put a little bit of blood that drips out of your nose. Do something, I said, because that'll freak people out. He's like, okay, so this kid got up and he shook. The thing that in those situations that I always look at is, you know, I think about, I don't have any children, but I have nieces and nephews, and I have, I can do what we call substitute things in my head for those moments. But really, if you're watching a young child die in front of you, which I, in my, that imaginary world, which when David and I, or Eve Miles, or Gareth, anybody who was involved in that show, those imaginary worlds, when we were doing them, they were completely real. That was real to us. That was another world that we were creating, which is why I think you all went and caught on to it and loved it. Because that we treated it. We didn't treat it like, how stupid is this, da da da. Never, ever did we think that. So I think that's what makes those scenes work. People used to come up to me in the supermarket, walk past me, and these women, you know, men would come up, these women would go out and get in the frozen food section. And go looking, like I'm in the frozen food section, what do you think? Getting fish fingers. Fish finger sandwich with ketchup, delicious.
Yeah.
Anyway, it's like a hot, what is it, a hot? Hot brown. Yeah. I told you I had a hot brown the other night. He's like, really? He said, I don't know what to make of that.
Oh, my goodness.
I said, it's not what you think. So she came up to me, she walked up, she said, I have to tell you, I think you're awful.
Oh!
But I still love you. And I don't understand why you killed him. Away. And I'm standing there going, bye. She turned around, she went, but I'll still watch, bye! So to have that kind of dilemma as a person who watches, that's exactly what we wanted, because the whole point of doing that, and the whole point of that series, that whole arc of that show was, if you were in a position, and you had a family member of that age, and you were the one that was on, the weight was on, would you sacrifice that family member to save the entire planet. Would you do it? Right? Mm-hmm. Some people would say yes, others would say no. For those who say, you know, so that's the dilemma Jack was in. And he would sacrifice anything to save humanity, the same as the doctor would. So that was it.
Thank you. Wow.
Yes.
I was wondering when you were informed that your character, Captain Jack, was actually going to be the face of Bub.
It was a shock. First of all, the fact that they think that that's what I'm going to look like. Because I know the guy they actually modeled the face on. And his name is Arwell Jones. And he was the props designer and master for the show. And they just took a picture of his face and smushed it. But it was funny because Bo used to lie on the floor in the warehouse when we would film it. You know, that's what's great about working on the shows, because we all filmed in Treforest. And, you know, in the WHO studios, as we used to call it, and the Torchwood studios, you'd walk past going to lunch, there'd be a Cyberman, there'd be a Weevil, there's the face of Bo, there's a Dala, as you walk through to go to the canteen. But David and I were filming, I can't remember the episode that was prior to that. Someone will know.
Utopia?
What?
Utopia.
Has it been?
Utopia.
Utopia, thank you. We were filming Utopia, the scripts hadn't come out. And when they did come out, I'm in my trailer, sitting between, you know, takes, just having a break, looking at lines that are yet to come, in the sequence that I'm going to run next to David again, and we're going to have a race. But I'm in boots, and you're in Converse! And you're also this big! And I'm this big! But we're both this big! I hear this. Like, yes, I'm coming! What? John, dip. Oh my God, you won't believe what just happened. I just read through. Don't tell me! I don't want to know! But it's John! Come on, get up! Out he goes. Next day, he comes up and he goes, you're in the script, Henry. You're in the script. I'm like, no! Don't tell me anything! He goes, come on, John, you've got to read the script. So when we're together, we talk Scottish together, right? I'm like, David, if you tell me what's fucking going on in that script, I'll bail you! Just tell me when you read it, okay? All right, fine, okay? So, next day, lunchtime. Do I read it? Me running. I hear, what? David! What? You said it yesterday! You really? It took so many takes to do that scene because I walked away, all casual. Martha, the doctor, stand there. I walked away and I go, you know, when I was in the Beauchene Peninsula, they used to call, I was the poster child for the Time Agency, they used to call me the face of Bo. On my shot, I'm going to, all of a sudden, Martha and David are going. Sorry, Freeman, David. They're like, and I'm like, I'm trying to do a shot here. I'm serious. So when that episode came out, we usually had get-togethers when things were, you know, the episodes were going on and we wanted to watch a big special episode. And I was sitting in my flat and all the rest were in the Cardiff Bay. We called it Who Towers, where we all lived. And that was a great building. God forbid anything happened there, because the whole universe of Doctor Who would have been wiped out in one blow. So we, when the episode happened, I went up to the window and I opened the window. I can't remember who turned to me and said, you know, what are you doing to the window, John? And I opened the window and I said, I'm just listening to hear the nation's jaw drop. And literally, the whole nation was like, oh. That was awesome. Great. I actually, when I did read the script, I went up to back to Russell because his flat was down below mine between David's. And I walked up to her and said, "What were you smoking?"
Yeah.
So it was good. Good episode.